तो
लेकिन
आई
ये
एमी,
जी
हाय एमी, हाउ
हाय
आर यू
सर,
डूइंग?
आई एम गुड, हाउ आर यू?
गुड, वेरी गुड. सो हाउ इज इट गोइंग, द कैलकुलस पार्ट?
या ऑलराइट, जस्ट यू नो गेटिंग अ फ्यू कॉन्सेप्ट्स एंड पुटिंग इट ऑल टुगेदर.
ओके, ग्रेट. आई एम अनिल कुमार. वेलकम. टू स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ माइन आर हियर, वन फ्रॉम यूके, वन फ्रॉम जर्मनी. In previous two classes, we did introduction to calculus, and we actually understood two basic concepts. One was the concept of limit, and the second was the difference quotient, which gives you the tangent for any point on the curve. Now, today, we'll actually take exam review on this particular topic. And with that, I'll also take an example which I thought we missed last time. But to complete this chapter, we will see how to sketch a graph of a gradient from the given function. So that's kind of interesting, which we'll take. Now, Emmy, how was this journey of learning, and how do you find the explanation so far?
So I definitely found the introduction to calculus very helpful, because obviously before we start calculus, we want to have a nice good understanding of concepts and skills that we use throughout calculus. So it was really good to consolidate my learning in that section, hopefully making it easier when we get into calculus.
Mujeeb, what do you think?
Yeah, it's mere liye bahut theek hai. Main bahut samajh gaya hoon jab se main aapke saath padh raha hoon. कैलकुलस बहुत आसान हो गया है मेरे लिए.
That's very good.
और मैं आपका बहुत शुक्रगुजार हूँ. और इंशाल्लाह मैं मेरे मैथमेटिक्स के नोट अच्छे हो जाएंगे.
Hopefully, definitely, Najib, I'll try my best. Now, in today's lecture, we'll take up the four questions which we had for examination, and also I'll also go through a particular concept where we will see how to sketch the gradient of a function, right? So let me share the screen with you now. This is, I think, yes, that's the one. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Yes, both of you can see the screen. So that's what we are going to start with. So as I told you, this is going to be our last lecture on introduction to calculus. We are going to end with exam review. So we'll estimate value of E. That was the very first question in exam review. Let me share with you the four questions. The first question was, given E equals to limit of x, 1 plus x to the power of 1 over x. That is actually the formula for E. You can actually calculate the value of E, the approximate value of E, using this particular formula. We understood the concept of limit approaching x approaching 0. That is to say that from both the sides, we have to approach the value of x to 0. And when that happens, the value of E can be found to 3 or 4 decimal places in this particular case. So, Amy and Najib, could you do this question?
Yeah.
So, what was your concept and how did you approach?
I used the table of values.
Perfect. That is just the right way. So, what I did was, I have a solution right here for all of you. So that is what you should be doing. As you can see from the screen, that we are actually approaching from the left side, and we are also approaching from the right side. So the idea here is to approach the value from both left side and from the right side. So let me highlight as we move along. So this is the quotient, which is what we should be looking at, right? Now, when you approach from the left side, that is to say that the x values are 0.1, negative, negative 0.01, negative 0.001, negative 0.0001. So that is very, very small, close to zero. We approach a value which is 2.7184178. On the other hand, the table shows the values being approached from the right-hand side of zero. So from 0.1, we come down to 0.01. Even closer, 0.001, and very close to 0, 0.0001. That gives us 4 decimal place accuracy for the value of E, which is 2.7184. Is that very clear, right?
Yeah.
That was our first question. And the second question here is, Amy, can you read the question for me?
At point P on the parabola, y equals 3x squared plus x, the gradient is 13. Find the coordinates of point P.
So in this find the equation.
Find the equation of tangent line at this point.
Perfect. So in this equation, we were supposed to use the difference quotient formula and then work it out. So could you get the solution of this question?
Yeah.
Okay, so what was your approach?
So I found the gradient function as f, so 6x plus 1.
Yeah.
And then I subbed in, so 6x plus 1 equals 13.
That's the gradient given. Perfect. Yeah.
I got x equals 2. And then I subbed the 2 back into the equation f of x. So y equals 3x squared plus x. And then I got the point P as 2.14.
Perfect. And did you find the equation of the tangent line also?
Yeah. I just used the difference quotient formula.
Perfect. And that is how it should be done. And I think here is the solution, which I've just done exactly what Emmy did. So we are given the function f of x, which is 3x squared plus x. You find the function f of x plus h. So replace x with x plus h, and you get that particular function. Now, gradient is limit h approaches 0, f of x plus h minus f of x over h. Gradient is given to us as 13. So we can simplify this equation, equate 13. 13 equals to 6x plus 1, as Emmy was saying, x is 2. Plug in 2 to get the value of y. Once you get the value of y, it's very easy to find the equation of the tangent line, since you know the slope is 13 and the point is given to you. So for the convenience, I've also shown the graph with the tangent line, right? It makes sense?
Yeah.
Now let's look into the third question, which is, the point A lies on the curve, f of x equals to x cubed. At A, the curve has gradient of g. Write an expression for g. So what will you do for this?
Well, I use the difference quotient formula again.
Perfect. And then you get what is given in part
three squared.
Yeah. So Emmy, this is how most of your questions will be for GCSE. So they kind of help you to get the solution, and they provide you subsections so that you can do one by one and get your final answer. And then you found the equation of the normal, right? So the slope of the normal is negative reciprocal of the slope of the tangent line. Perfect. Here is the solution for the convenience of all our viewers. So the question three. Again, the approach is exactly same. Write the function, write f of x plus h. In this case, it is whole cube. Expand. So you should know the expansion for a plus b whole cube. Use Pascal's triangle also to expand binomials with higher powers. Now, once you expand and simplify, h gets canceled. Then you plug in 0. And you get an expression for gradient, which is limit h approaches 0, h squared minus 9h plus 27. So that was part B completed. And now we need to find the equation of the normal at a given point where x is equals to minus 3. So when you plug in minus 3, you get the y value. So you know the point. And also minus 3 gives you a gradient, which is 27 in this particular case. Now, when you find the equation of the line, you could use different forms of equations of the lines. In this particular example, I've used y minus y0 equals to m times x minus x0. And then you get the standard form of the equation. That is how it could be solved. So I hope that is absolutely clear. Now, let's take the last question of our previous test paper. Question number four here is, the line L is tangent to the curve y equals to 3x squared plus 1. L cuts the y-axis at 0 minus 11. Find the equation L. Now, could you get this particular question?
I mean, I got something. I don't know if it's right.
Okay, so what was your approach?
So I found the gradient function, and I got that 6x. So that's the gradient of the tangent.
Yes.
And then you said, so make a point. So we need to find the point on the curve.
Yes.
So I made it as A and then F of A. Mm-hmm. So then I subbed in A into 6x.
Okay.
Yeah, and then I got 6A as...
gradient, yeah. Correct?
Yeah, and then I put that 6A back into the formula. Mm-hmm. I got it as y equals x plus like 0.9. That doesn't sound right.
Okay, so I think halfway you were perfectly fine. So as I was saying, question number 4 is a very typical question. So here is it. The line L is tangent to the curve y equals to 3x squared plus 1. L cuts the y-axis at 0 minus 11. Find the point of tangency and the equation L. Now to solve this question, let us first sketch the diagram itself. So we have a parabola here, which is shown in blue color. That is y equals to 3x squared plus 1. Now the y-axis point is the y-intercept, which is 0 minus 11, which is marked right there. Now in this particular case, as you can see, the point is external, right? So we have a point which is actually outside the curve, the y-intercept. It is not on the curve. We basically do not know at which point on the curve will it be tangent. So we have to assume that point to be with x value of a. Therefore, what we have taken here is that let the line L be tangent at a point P, A, f of a. So if x value is a, then the y value will be f of a. I should have written f of a as I have written here, right? Now, the slope from the point at y-intercept and f of a can be given by the standard formula of gradient, which is y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. In this particular case, f of a minus 11 will be y2 minus y1, and x2 minus x1 will be a minus 0, right? How do you get the value of f of a? Well, substitute a in the function itself, which is 3x squared plus 1. So what you get here is 3a squared plus 1 for f of a, and minus becomes plus, you get plus 1. Simplifying this particular expression, we get 3a squared plus 12 over a. So that is the gradient of the line which connects the tangential point at x equals to a with the y-intercept 0 minus 11, right? So that point is absolutely clear. Now we have to get another equation to find the value of a. How do you get that? Well, you could use difference quotient method, the formula written here, very familiar. Limit h approaches 0 for f of a plus h minus f of a over h. Now from here, if I substitute a plus h in the given equation y equals to 3x squared plus 1, I get 3 times a plus h whole squared plus 1 minus f of a, which is 3 squared plus 1. Now if you simplify this, what do you get? Once you simplify, h and h gets cancelled here, right? So they get cancelled, and you get an equation where we could substitute h equals to 0 and then get our answer as 6a. So as Emmy was saying, the gradient is indeed 6a. Now, this gradient of 6a can be equated to the gradient, which we already found, and that is what is done here. So you equate the two gradients. They have to be same. They are representing the same set of points, which is on the tangent, right? Solving this equation, which is quadratic in nature, we actually get two values for a, plus and minus 2, as you can see from here. So the other point is on the left side, right? So there are actually two points of tangency, as you can see in this particular case, with the y-intercept at 0 minus 11. So now we know the points on the curve, which happens to be 2, and we have a y-intercept, which is 0 minus 11. And now we are in a position to write the equation of both these lines, correct? So we'll have these set of points 2, 13, and minus 2, 13, along with the y-intercept point, which is 0 minus 11, right? So that is the y-intercept. Now, you could write the equation in different forms. We are using the slope-intercept form of the line. The y equals to mx plus b is the standard equation. We know the y-intercept is minus 11. So you could substitute minus 11 in the equation itself and then get the equation. So we have this equation, line one, could be 12x minus 11. How did I get 12x? Well, I substituted a value of 2 in the slope or the gradient, m equals to 6a, right? So when I substitute 2 here, I get the slope of 12, and that's how I get 12. And when I substitute minus 2, I get minus 12, and the second equation. For both, the y-intercept is 11. So these are the two equations which we get for the given condition. So I hope you've understood how to solve such questions. So it's kind of tricky. So we landed up with two, not one tangent. Perfect. So that is how it should be solved. I hope the concept is absolutely clear. So let's move on with the next question now. So I hope you understood that sometimes when the point is outside the curve, you would actually get two tangents from that point. It's kind of important to write the equation of both the tangents. Many times in the equation, there will be word like tangents or gradients. That may give you a hint. And even otherwise, when you are given a question like this, it is very important to check whether the given point is on the curve or not. If it is not there on the curve, then we have to use this particular strategy. I hope that makes sense. So now let's continue with the next question, where we are going to learn how to sketch the graph of a gradient from the given function. But now let's get to a very important part of this particular video, where we are going to learn how to sketch graph of a function which is shown here in this particular page. So Najib and Amy, do you see this particular graph here?
Yeah.
We have written points A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, right? Mm-hmm. Now, this is a very important exercise. We have learned all about what is the gradient and how to find gradient from the equations and also from the graph. Now, we have a graph here. I'd like you to copy a similar graph, or you can answer me the questions I can write down here. The question here is to sketch the graph for the gradient of this particular function. So how will you sketch the gradient of this particular function? Can you suggest how to go about?
Would you start by, so I would start with the turning points.
Okay.
So C and E.
Yeah.
I'll put like horizontal lines.
Yes.
So that's where the gradient is zero. Okay. So
these two points, gradient is zero. I think that's perfectly fine. So you know the gradient zero here, and you know C and E are gradient zero. So the table on the side, which I have mentioned along with this, really helps you to find the solution. So Amy, you're right. You start with C and E, so you know that the gradient is zero at these two points. So you can mark those points on the graph, right? That's what you're kind of trying to say?
Yeah.
So those two points on the graph. So we have this. Now, what will you do next? So, Amy, what next?
Would you do the endpoints?
Yes, that is correct. Endpoints you can check. So the endpoints are A and G. So what is happening there at A and G?
What is happening? Well,
what is the gradient?
So at A, it's kind of zero. But
it's approaching zero, right? You're right.
Yeah.
So we can say that at A, it is approaching zero, right? So in my table, I can write that it is becoming zero at the turning point, which are C and E, correct? So I'm trying to write here. And at A, it is approaching zero. So it is A, which is approaching zero. And even at G, it is approaching zero, correct?
Mm.
Now from the graph, you can see that there are areas where the gradient is positive, greater than zero. So can you tell me which part of the graph the gradient is greater than zero?
Sorry, could you repeat?
So on the graph, which part is with gradient greater than zero, positive gradient?
D.
At D it is negative because it is coming down.
What?
Positive.
A to C.
Is increasing and increasing, and from E to G also it is increasing. So the gradient is positive from A to C and from E to G, correct? In the center from C to E, it is negative. Perfect. Now, we have positive negative gradients. Now, another important thing which we need to consider is where is the gradient maximum and where is the gradient minimum? So let me tell you this part. The gradient changes from positive, increasing positive to decreasing positive. At B, unit starts with zero, it increases. And then the rate of change of increase reduces at C to zero, correct? Gradient at C is zero, but positive at B. So at B, it is the maximum positive value. Okay? You also call the point B as the point of inflection. At this particular point, we expect a maximum. And the minimum will be at F, where the gradient is picking up, right? So earlier it was zero at E, right? I mean minimum at E, zero at E, and then it is kind of increasing, and then the increase is at F changing, the point of inflection is changing. So what we notice here is that the graph is increasing, and this is about the gradient increasing. So last column which I made is about the gradient. So gradient is increasing or gradient is decreasing. We also say the curve is concave up or concave down, right? So at point B, the concavity changes and that makes the gradient as maximum. Now you can take all these points, and to find the real value of maximum and minimum gradient, you can actually draw tangent at B, draw tangent at F, and then find the gradient and plug in the values. Once you have the maximum minimum values, you can actually sketch. So what I did was that I actually calculated these values and I have written here as a summary. So we notice that the gradient is zero at C and E, gradient is approaching zero at A and G, gradient is greater than zero from A to C and E to G, gradient is less than zero between C and E. The maximum value, if you draw a tangent at B, will be 1.2, and the minimum value for the gradient will be at F, and it'll be D. Minimum will be at D, negative 0.5. The concavity changes from concave down to concave up, right? So at D, we have a minimum of 0.5. Now, we also notice that the graph, the gradient is increasing from A to B and from D to it concave up. It is concave up, increasing gradient. Concavity, I should write. So this is the concavity. We are saying concave up. And this portion is concave down. This is rate of change of gradient value. Perfect. Once you incorporate all these values, the graph of the gradient will look something like this, which is shown in orange. So I'd like you to make a note of this particular graph, which is the graph of the gradient of the given function. Now here you can see, as we had been discussing, that if you start from the left-hand corner, it approaches zero, since the gradient at A was approaching zero. At B, we have a maximum value of the gradient, and thereafter, it actually decreases. the gradient becomes negative after C hitting the minimum value at D, minimum value of around minus 0.5. And then it starts increasing further, getting to the maximum at F, and then again approaches zero. You will also see that the graph was symmetric, and therefore its gradient is also symmetric. Perfect. Now, if you notice clearly, do you make a note on how do we get the maximum point? See the concavity. From A to D, it is concave up, right?
Yeah.
And from B to C, it is concave down. So from up to down, it hits the maximum. Correct?
So is that a rule?
Yeah, that's a rule. And then from down, this is down, concave down. And then it again picks up concavity, I'm saying, right? Concave up. Do you see that? So when it becomes concave down to concave up, it hits the minimum.
Okay.
So to find the maximum or the minimum points, you have to check change in concavity. And that is what I meant when I was saying increasing and decreasing. It is increasing and decreasing change in gradient, I meant, right? So not clearly written there. So next maximum is when the concavity changes from increasing to, I mean, concave up to concave down. Do you see that again? So when you have concave up and then concave down and you hit the maximum once again. Perfect. So when you look at the graph of the function, you have to begin with the turning points. Those correspond to zeros on the gradient. Go to the end point so that you understand the end behavior. Look for the point of inflections where the concavity is changing. Those point of inflections will give you maximum and minimum values on the gradient. If the concavity is changing from concave up to concave down, you will get the maximum on the gradient. When the concavity changes from concave down to concave up, you are going to get the minimum as shown here. Symmetry, as we discussed earlier, plays a major role. If you would have noticed that this graph was symmetric, in that case, we could have only solved half of the side, and we know the other half is a replica of that as shown here. Perfect. So that really helps. Symmetry also helps to check your answers. So I think that makes sense. Perfect. So with that, we actually conclude our last session where we checked into most of the questions, rather four examination questions. And again, we revisited the technique of sketching the graph of gradient from the graph of the function. Perfect. So how do you find this? Did you understand today's session?
Yeah, it's just graphing it and getting the points.
I think you're right. So we need to practice a bit more on graphing of the gradient. It's kind of tricky. And the other part could be, you could also practice with, given the gradient, how to get the function. So reverse, right? So both ways. So Amy, could you summarize for me, if you have to graph the gradient from the function, what are you going to do and how will you do it?
So I would start with some turning points, mark the turning points, and then plot the gradient, because at turning points the gradient is zero, so then you plot the points. Then we talked about finding so the end points.
Yes.
And you check whether it's concave up or concave down. Then you have to find the maximum and minimum. So to find those, you have to check the concavity. Is that how you say it? So if it changes from up to down, you got your maximum point. And if it changes from down to up, you got your minimum point.
Good. And to find the value, draw the tangent on the curve, right? And then make a triangle. Rise over run will give you approximate value. That is good enough to sketch your graph, right? So because you may not be in a position to get the equation of this particular graph, right? So when you are doing on the graph, you have to always draw a tangent line. You get rise over run, calculate the rise over run. That's the gradient. And plug that value into your graph for accuracy.
Perfect. All
right. And then the end points are also very important so that you know how does it end. So that is how you're going to do the graph of the gradient. So Amy, with that, I think we have understood the introduction, and the now we have also two main things which we need to know about calculus is limits and derivatives. So limits is approaching some value. In our case, most of the time, since we were talking about gradient, our limit of h was approaching zero, or delta x was approaching zero, right? Now, when we take limits, it could be approaching any value a at which we are interested in finding the limit. The second part of the calculus is gradient, and that gradient is actually called derivatives. So when you hear the name derivatives, you should connect it with gradient or rate of change. So derivative is actually providing you slope of a tangent line at any particular point on the graph itself. So the whole exercise which we did, getting the gradient from the first principles was a practice to get the gradient to understand your graph. And then from the graph also, drawing a tangent and getting the gradient is a good exercise, since most of the time the graphs are so complex that you cannot get equation easily.
Yeah.
But you can find the gradient by drawing a tangent and then rise over run. So that introduces us to two major topics, limits and derivatives. We'll now begin with limits in our next session. And I hope you find it interesting and useful. I will suggest now you could actually complete the exercise from your notebook. And if there are any difficulties, share the questions with me. Okay?
Thank you so much, sir.
My pleasure. Thanks a lot. And see you in the next session.
Bye, sir.
Bye. All the best.